Okay, that was probably a bad idea. That kind of hurt. Woo! Oh, man. Okay. So I figured this would be a little easier for me considering how I was about ready to rip off my back. Or not rip off my back, rip off my spine and use it as a jump rope. But because my back was in so much pain, I figured, this would probably be a little easier because this is going to be the last collection video I record for right now because I do have some other stuff I do want to do. But so I'm going to do this video right here. And I gotta say, it's a lot more comfortable, mainly because I can lean back and not have to lean forward. So yeah, I do gotta fix that. That's gonna be a New Year's resolution. Sit straight up. Don't slouch. No, I don't want to be a hunchback of Notre Dame. I already have this big fucking head. So, having this big head and having a big old ass hump on the back of my back. The back of my back. I don't know why I said it like that. But you guys get what I mean. It's just, ooh. Luckily, my fiance loves my big head. I should have worded that a lot more better because someone's going to take that very sexually. I'm so glad I caught that. I don't know if I'm glad I caught that. I just realized something. I never noticed his face on here. Huh. So, pretty much what we're going to be talking about in this video is one of my specialties, which is nerdy stuff. Comic booky stuff. Comic book movies. I think I will do a comic book collection video. I kind of did one for Chilled Chaos, but I kind of want to do one that's like this. I gotta fix my hoodie. I should be wearing my hoodie during this video. Oh well, my Spider-Man hoodie. Anyways, yeah, I'm gonna be talking about comic book movies, pretty much my DVD collection, more than anything. And yeah, that's well, let's just get this video started off with because if there's one thing I love more than anything, it's comic book movies and getting all nerdy about them. Which is funny, considering I'm about ready to talk about a DC movie that, I'm not too big of a fan of DC, but this has a little bit of dust on it. I'm not too big of a fan of DC. I don't know too much about their heroes and villains, though funny enough, I was never a big fan of Superman, but I know a lot of his villains and a lot of his backstory for some reason. I think I gotta blame the Justice League animated series for that. But anyways, let's continue on with movie number one, which is going to be Green Lantern D. I thought this was the extended cut. Which, to be honest, this is one of those movies that it's not really an extended cut because there's not really much added to it. But yes, the Green Lantern movie. This movie was extremely panned. But in all honesty, I feel like if they had a better script and a better villain, and they saved Parallax for last, like in terms of last, like if they were to do a trilogy, I feel like Parallax would be a good villain for a second or third movie. I feel like this would have been a very, very solid movie. Though I will say this, I do enjoy this movie. Granted, like I said, I do notice its flaws. I do. I notice its flaws. It's definitely not one of my favorite superhero movies, but in terms of DC, it's enjoyable. At least for me, it's like a guilty pleasure type of movie. And I will get a lot of hate for this. I do think it's better than Man of Steel. I actually didn't feel bored watching this movie. And Man of Steel, I thought Man of Steel had a lot of issues. And then, what's funny about Man of Steel is that a lot of people think people who hate the movie hate it for all the destruction. It's like, open your mind a little bit and realize, there's a lot more other reasons why or possibly why people don't like the movie. For me, I have like four or five issues with that movie. And it's not like the destruction might be one of them. I'm not entirely sure, but the other reasons I have top that because as a movie as a whole, I just thought it was a mess. I thought it was horrible. But Green Lantern, I didn't feel bored in it. But while I do notice its flaws in the movie, the script and the villains, because, Dr. Hammond, what's funny? Dr. Hammond kind of looks like a younger version of my fiance's dad without the giant cranium. But yeah, you know, if it definitely needed a lot improvement. But compared to Man of Steel, and the reason why I compare it to Man of Steel is because it's the most recent DC film, it's just, in my opinion, it's more enjoyable, and I'd rather watch this movie than Man of Steel. And I probably would, I don't know if I would want to watch this movie or Dark Knight Rises more, but you guys get the picture. That's pretty much how I feel. Next up is X-Men: The Last Stand, which a lot of people give this movie a lot of hate, and I don't quite understand why. I can see why people are not a fan of it, but I don't see exactly why people hate it. It's still an enjoyable movie, in my opinion. Like, you don't need a movie to be perfectly written and have this big meaning, or you guys get what I mean. You don't need all this really big stuff to have a movie that's enjoyable. And in my opinion, X-Men 3 is an enjoyable movie. It's an enjoyable X-Men film. Is it the best X-Men film? Hell no. And I can't say it's the worst one because, you know, you have X-Men Origins Wolverine. But it's still an enjoyable movie, in my opinion. In my opinion, it's better. It falls down in terms of, say, Green Lantern. You know, it's an enjoyable movie. You can see its flaws, but in the end, you still enjoy it. That's how I feel with X-Men 3. I definitely wish that we saw what Bryan Singer had planned for it, because, you know, he's proven that he's, you know, really good with directing, and I think he writes the X-Men movies. But I would have really loved to see what he was planning out for X-Men 3 before he went to Superman Returns. But yeah, that's pretty much all I can really say about this. I don't really understand the hate, but it's still an enjoyable movie, at least to me. Ghost Rider. I was excited for this movie. Eva Mendez is smoking hot. I have a thing for Hispanic women. Don't ask me why. I just, something about Hispanic women, which, funny enough, my fiance is German and Puerto Rican. That's a big plus, especially since I'm German, or part German. But yeah, I was excited to see this movie because, you know, it was Ghost Rider, and, you know, I don't know too much about Ghost Rider, except, you know, I think it was mainly because I wanted to see Mephisto and Blackheart. But what this movie gave us was an fest. Like, it was, I never saw the second one, just so you guys know. I never saw Spirit of Vengeance, but it felt like a video game because he goes from one area to fight one guy, he goes to another area to fight another guy. It felt very video game-ish how he fought these guys. And to top it off, the fights were interesting. They were not interesting at all. And in terms of plot, it was all right. Okay, it wasn't all right. It was okay. I give the plot like 2 stars. You know, X-Men 3 had a better plot, just to say. But is it a movie I would watch? Yeah, I'd probably put it on while I'm making dinner or something. That's how I can rate it. I think I got this for Christmas or something. It was just not. It was an okay movie. It was. I don't know. I just don't watch it a lot. That's how I feel about the movie. I was excited for it, but it just feels too video game-ish. Every time I watch it, I just think of like an old classic video game. You're just going through areas, and then eventually, you know, you go into an area that's just empty, and all you have is the boss. That's how I feel about that movie. Yeah. I really hope Marvel does it better. I actually would love it if they did a next. I would really love it if they did it for a next Netflix series, but I don't know. I don't know if on Netflix seeing Ghost Rider's head would look really good or really bad. And in my opinion, if you're gonna use Mephisto or Blackheart, Ghost Rider's just gonna have a lot of CGI involved, and I don't know if I want to see it on Netflix at all. I would like to see it in the movies, but then again, I would also like to see it on you know, teamed up with Daredevil, Punisher, or, you know, those guys, because I think they do have a team with Ghost Rider. I'm not entirely sure. Like I said, I don't know too much about Ghost Rider, but I don't know. I don't know. I feel like he would be best fit for Netflix, but at the same time, you know, the CGI wise, part of me would rather see him in the movies. Just to say, I don't know how CGI would look if Netflix did it. Next up, Hellboy 2. I actually preferred this one over Hellboy 1, which I still enjoyed Hellboy 1 a lot. But Hellboy 2 was just an overall fun time. It felt a lot more lighthearted, in my opinion. And the first Hellboy movie was dark, but it still had the kind of serious comedic tone, but it felt darker than this one. But I really enjoyed this movie. I might buy Hellboy 1 later on. I'm not entirely sure. But if I had to say which one I preferred, it would definitely be this one. And I really hope Del Toro is a Del Toro. Hold on. Yeah, it's Del Toro. I really hope he makes a third movie because, this movie is just, I enjoyed a lot of it. I enjoy this pretty much every time I watch it. I don't get bored with it. And the reason why those movies were pretty much listed first is because they were on the top shelf over there, and well, they were right in front of me. Alright, so let's go on with. Let's see. This is for five movies. God, this thing squeaks a lot. The disc might be popped out. X-Men Days of Futures Past. Really enjoyed the movie. Though, I will say, I do have a problem with the ending. Like, I feel like they didn't. I feel like when it comes to time travel movies, they have to explain how everything works when you change the timeline. And that was one of my biggest complaints with the movie was the ending. It just, everything didn't make sense, and I really wish they explained it. But overall, I really enjoyed the movie. And after this whole debacle with Apocalypse and how Jennifer Lawrence, I did make a video about it and I took it down just because I feel like I worded it wrong. But my problem's not with the movie, it's with the actress and how she's just a, in short, a diva, and how basically in Apocalypse, she did confirm this that, she talked to him and she's not gonna be blue or pretty much naked throughout most of Apocalypse. And that just pisses me off, and that makes me dislike her because, it's kind of like how Jason Momoa is with the whole blonde hair thing with Aquaman. Though I will say with Jennifer Lawrence, it's I don't really care with Jason Momoa and Aquaman. It makes I can understand his point of view, but with Jennifer Lawrence, it was I can understand her point of view too because I from what my fiance's sister said, apparently she has to wear a butt plug. But yeah, apparently she has to wear a butt plug though, and I can understand a little problem with that. But in the end, it's ruining the character of Mystique, and I'm starting to kind of dislike Jennifer Lawrence more and more I hear about her, which is sad because she's a great actress, and I do think she's good as Mystique. But her not being blue, she's just pretty much looking human throughout most of the movie. It completely just ignores her character because, Brotherhood of Mutants and, well, Brotherhood of Mutants is basically be proud of who you are, be proud of your powers, don't hide them. And her looking like a human just completely ignores all that. So that actually pisses me off that she's actually the reason why they're pretty much doing that in Apocalypse. Though in the trailer, if you pause at a certain moment, you can see that she is blue. But like I said, she's probably not going to be blue for most of the film, which, like I said, is completely stupid. And I think that is a horrible decision on their part, and they should just recast her. Sounds really bad, but that's just how I feel. Guardians of the Galaxy. A really good movie. I would probably say a little bit overhyped because, I really love the movie. It was probably one of the few MCU movies I really enjoyed. Like I don't know exactly what my thoughts were. Like I knew what my thoughts were, but I don't remember what my thoughts were, because it's been like 2 or 3 years since this movie came out. Probably say 2 years. And it had something about it that I liked more than other Marvel cinematic movies. I don't remember what it was, but when I watched, I was like, this, it was probably like the feels meter. Like, I felt I think it was more like I felt more of a connection, I guess. Like, I don't exactly remember what it was. I really hope she doesn't call right now. But yeah, this movie just did something for me that the other MCU movies didn't do. I just don't remember what it was. But I will say my main issue with this movie was the final battle. It was all amazing. It was just spectacular to look at. But that dance off, that just a lot of people love that dance off, but that's my least favorite. Like that, and from the point the dance off starts to the point where Ronan is gone, I didn't like it. It's just, I just thought, I don't know, just it was not, it was definitely my least favorite part about the entire movie. But yeah, overall, it's a great movie. I really enjoyed it. So yeah. God, my eye is starting to itch. Captain America: The First Avenger. Really good movie. I really don't have much to say negatively about it. I think it was overall a very well-made film. It fit for the tone that it was going for, which was basically setting it in the same time period. You know, it felt like, while it looks like a movie, made nowadays, the way they edited like that montage in the movie, it felt like a movie. If it fit with what the time period was in the movie, basically. So overall, I think it was a great movie. And if Civil War is great, I definitely think Captain America movies are going to be the first perfect trilogy, which will also be weird considering that, in terms of Winter Soldier and Civil War, they feel like they're made, like they're part of the same movie universe. But with Winter Soldier, it definitely has a different feel slash tone to it compared to, Winter Soldier and what Civil War looks to be. But overall, if, like I said, if Civil War is great, which it's most likely will be, then I think Captain America will have the first perfect superhero trilogy, because a lot of trilogies for superhero movies, they seem like they missed the mark on the third movie. Next up is Thor. Personally, I like this movie more than Thor 2. Thor 2 has got to be my least favorite movie in Phase 2. Actually, it might be my least favorite movie throughout the entire Marvel cinematic movies. But yeah, Thor 1, I actually really enjoyed. Definitely would watch this. I don't know if I'd watch it over and over again, but a lot of people give this movie too much slack. I think they did a great job for what they had to deal with, because, Thor is more of a, out of all the movies, out of all the superheroes they have to deal with right now, or at the time, because, you have Doctor Strange coming up soon, and you have Ant-Man. Thor was definitely was definitely the most complicated in terms of Iron Man, Hulk, Captain America, and I think that was it. In terms of main superheroes, because you have also Black Widow and Hawkeye. But in terms of the movies back, of the heroes they were using back then, Thor was the most complicated, and with what they did, I think they did a great job. I think this is easily the best they could ever have gotten. Like, no matter who you got to write this movie and whoever you got to direct this movie, I think easily this would have been the best you would have gotten. So, I really enjoyed the film. I just don't understand the slack for it. Next up is a movie I really wanted to see because, I'm a fan of the Arkham games. Batman: Assault on Arkham. I actually was supposed to watch this movie with my fiance when she was down here. But really good movie. Doesn't make a lot of sense in terms of, where it fits in the timeline, because certain things from Arkham Origins to Arkham Knight, it doesn't exactly fit. I don't know. But either way, good movie. It's just, when you think about it, you don't really see how it fits, in terms of the timeline. It just seems like it's a fan fiction type movie, Like it feels like it's part of the Arkham universe, but at the same time, it feels like a really well, like someone who's a fan wrote a really good fan fiction, but it just doesn't feel like it connects. It feels like it's missing something, or it's missing a couple things that doesn't make any sense. But good movie. I really like the animation. Right, next five. X-Men First Class. One of my favorite X-Men movies. It's very underrated. I know it's Armin's favorite movie overall, like favorite super, pretty much I know it's his favorite superhero movie in general. You know, even though he sees its flaws, he definitely says it's his number one favorite. I really enjoyed it. I don't know if I would say it's my favorite movie. It's definitely not my number one favorite superhero movie in general, but it's a really good movie. It's very underrated. The montage in the movie, it's all right. I actually prefer Captain America's montage, but you know, it's still a good movie. Michael Fassbender kills it as Magneto. This movie definitely made Mag I almost said Magneto. This movie definitely made Michael Fassbender one of my favorite actors pretty much right now. Though right now my favorite actor's gotta be Matt Damon and Chris Evans. I gotta say, and I'm gonna say this publicly too, so you guys can quote me all you want. I don't care. Because, you know, I would go gay for Chris Evans. I don't know what it is, but man, that man is sexy. Like, I'm straight as a doornail. But, you know, every man and woman, they have that certain person, like actress or just a person they know in real life. You know, everyone has that person that they just go like, you know, I would go gay for that person. No lie. Like, you can be straight as a doornail, but there's always got to be that same sex care like person. You're just like, yeah, I'd go for it. Like, you can't deny that. There's got to be at least one person. You know, that one person you just think about, like this girl I know. Her name is Ashley. Not gonna say her last name. She has, you know, she's straight as a doornail. Like, trust me, she is straight as hell. But if she had a chance, I'm pretty sure she would go all gay on Emma Watson. Though I'm sure a lot of women would, including myself. Not calling myself a woman, but you guys get what I mean. So, like, you can be as straight as you want, but there's always got to be at least one person you would go gay for. And for me, Chris Evans, you know, he has that personality, and then, you know, you see him in Captain America. I'm just saying. I think he has a man crush on, no, for me, it'd be Chris Evans or Thomas Jane, you know, man crush wise. And I think Armin has a man crush on Chris Hemsworth or Chris Evans. Like, if he could, I think he did say this once, he would totally go for one of those two. Thor or Captain America, he would go for one of them. Just saying. Batman Begins, my favorite. In terms of comic book accuracy, Batman Begins is my favorite Batman film. Really enjoyed it. That's pretty much all I'm going to say because I already talked about it in the Dark Knight trilogy in my Blu-ray collection. Iron Man. I like the movie. I enjoyed the movie. I think this movie is way too overhyped, though. Like I said, I enjoyed the movie, but a lot of people give this movie so much fucking praise that I'm like, it's not like a fucking masterpiece. At least in my opinion, it's not a masterpiece. You know, I have a like very, very few problems with it, but I wouldn't put this in my top 10. Like, if I had to say my top 10 for the MCU, this would be in the bottom. Or not the bottom, but it'd be after Iron Man 2, not after Iron Man 2, before Iron Man 2 and Thor: The Dark World. Because, you know, I really enjoyed it. Don't get me wrong, but a lot of people say it's a masterpiece, but I'm just like, I don't see it, you know? So don't hate me for it, but that's just my opinion. But like I said, I still really enjoyed it. You guys, I think I probably said this. Kick-Ass. I don't know if I already told you guys this, but Kick-Ass is one of the very few movies that I actually watched again and again. Because usually after I watch a movie, I don't want to watch it again for a while. Like, I'll enjoy a movie a lot. Don't get me wrong, I'll enjoy a movie a lot, but I'm not one of those people that can watch a movie again and again. It's like, I don't even understand how people can spend like $10 to go to see a movie in theaters so many fucking times. It's like, why? Though granted, I can't say too much on that because I did see Star Wars: The Force Awakens 3 times. I paid for two, And I did see Force Awakens with my fiance and her mom, or not her mom, her dad and her sister. And, they paid for it. But, I've seen this 3 times. But Kick-Ass 2, I didn't see it in theaters, but I saw it on DVD. And I watched it easily like 3 or 4 times in a row. I don't know about in a row, but I did see it. I did see it 2 times in a row. But I watched it like 2 more times afterwards. Really enjoyed this movie. It's one of my top. It's easily in my top 5 or top 10 favorite superhero movies of all time. Really enjoyed the living hell out of it. Next up is Dark Knight. I actually forgot I owned this on DVD. I didn't even realize I picked, I didn't even realize the Dark Knight was in my lap right there. So I've kind of been surprised. But you guys know pretty much my thoughts on the Dark Knight. If you guys don't, just watch my Blu-ray collection. I'm not going to waste your guys' time on it after just talking about it. But let's see. Kick-Ass. Let's see. Kick-Ass. I think Kick-Ass is the only one right now that's in my top 5. Kick-Ass. I might make a video talking about my top 10 favorite superhero movies. And I actually own all of them, I believe. So, yeah, that will come later. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Nope, I gotta pull you. Alright, pull you. You three can go there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. I want to at least talk about. I at least want to grab. It's about to slide. I at least want to talk. I at least want to talk. Or. I at least want to grab 5 movies to talk. Just saying. Iron Man 3. Easily my favorite Iron Man movie. And I'm pretty sure a lot of people are going to be like, oh, so you don't think Iron Man 1 is a masterpiece, but you love Iron Man 3. Look, Iron Man 3. Iron Man 1, he. This is what I will say about Iron Man 3 and why I think it's better than Iron Man 1. Okay? And I want you guys to hear me out on this. Iron Man 3, I feel like, has a more deeper meaning to it. Because this one definitely deals with Tony trying to, at the end of the movie, he's like, you can take away the suit, you can take all of my shit, but you will never take away, I don't remember his dialogue. But basically, without his, take away his suit, he's still Iron Man. That's pretty much what this movie's about, and that's why I love it a lot more, is because it has more of a deeper meaning to it. And I also want to clarify something. Iron Man has had some shitty villains in his last 2 movies. Whiplash was god awful. He's one of the worst villains they've ever had in the MCU movies. And then you have Ironmonger. He was good. Don't get me wrong, but he was good. He was just yeah. But Aldrich Killian, aka the Mandarin, aka not the Mandarin. I just realized people who probably didn't watch the movie, I just spoiled the movie right there. I'm so sorry about that. Forgive me. I wasn't thinking about that. But Aldrich Killian, easily one of the best villains I've seen so far in the MCU. Not saying he's the best one, but he's one of my favorites. A lot of people hate this movie just for the fact that, people gotta realize this, okay? Just because the trailers are more darker does not mean the movie should not have comedy in it. I was trying to think of a good way to say that. Because a lot of people went into this movie thinking they were going to get like The Dark Knight or something, where you barely get any comedy. And you can have a dark movie but still have comedy in it. You need something to lighten up the tone a bit because this is a dark movie. Well, it's not that dark of a movie. But you guys catch what I mean. It's more of a serious movie compared to Iron Man 1 and Iron Man 2. But you can't have, personally for me, if you're gonna make a serious story, you gotta have at least a couple of jokes in there to just lighten up the mood. And you can't change the character of Tony Stark with how he was in Iron Man 1 and 2. Put him in such a serious situation, he's still gonna be the same wisecracking asshole that you've seen in the last 2 movies. And a lot of people hate this movie also for the Mandarin twist because, well, I'm kind of mixed on it. I can definitely see a lot of reasons why it's actually a great idea why they did what they did. Because having the Mandarin with how he is in the comics, it wouldn't really work out too well in a movie. But then again, I will say this. A lot of people think, you know, with All Hail the King, that that was a cop-out for Marvel. Here's the thing, and, you know, I remember reading some of the comic issues that was a prelude to Iron Man 3. And, you know, when you see the movie, then you watch All Hail the King, and you read those comics, and you know, you've also seen the first two movies, you start to notice that a lot of things don't match up. And not in a bad way, like, say, like Asylum Arkham. I was trying to think of what movie I was just looking at. Like the things that happen in Iron Man 1 or Iron Man 2, and in the comic, it feels like what they did, like there's like ever since I watched it, I was like, I don't know, because I think there's an actual Mandarin somewhere out there, because a lot of things just didn't make sense. And I think I remember them saying like they actually got hit. They gave him plastic surgery to make him look like somebody. So a lot of things didn't make sense. So I'm like, I don't really think that was a cop out. I think that was the plan all along. So for me, Iron Man 3, it's a great movie. It's definitely my favorite one out of the trilogy. I got popcorn kernel in my gums. V for Vendetta. Easily my top 10. Really enjoyed this movie. It's one of those movies I can watch over and over again. It's very philosophical. You know, it's a really deep movie. I watched it. I actually got this when I was staying over at my fiance's house, and you know, me and her stayed up all night watching it because you know she's never seen it, and she liked it. I know she liked it. I don't know if she like loved it or anything. You know, she's always weird when she comes to expressing her opinions, which I do love her for that. She liked the movie and we watched it together, and you know, I overall just love this movie from beginning to end. No complaints whatsoever. I actually do want to try and get this on Blu-ray just to get more behind the scenes stuff because there's only three listed. Subtitles, language, Freedom Forever, Making V for Vendetta. My God, DVD special features fucking suck. The Punisher. What did they call it? The extended cut. I really love the extended cut. I love the Thomas Jane Punisher. I personally don't like Warzone. I don't really want to own Warzone, but I actually, you know, Warzone, I get why people like Warzone because it's more in tunes of how the violence is. But in my opinion, the Punisher, especially the extended cut, is overall a superior film. I loved it from beginning to end. I could watch it all the time. This has got to be in my top 10 as well. It's just I overall loved it. And then these two movies. Oh my God, these two movies hold a very special place in my heart. And I just realized there's another movie somewhere. I don't know where it is, but I'm just gonna say it right now. Fantastic Four: Rise of the Silver Surfer. Definitely my least favorite in the Fantastic Four. I don't know where it is, so that's why I'm not holding it for you guys. And just so you guys know, I did not see the reboot that came out last year, so that's why I'm saying Rise of the Silver Surfer is my least favorite. I'm not gonna see the reboot. I don't plan on it. So yeah, just want to say that real quick. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. These two have got to be my favorite. You know, I love the reboot. I can't wait for Out of the Shadows. I had to think of what it was. I was about to say Secret of the Ooze, but I can't wait for the sequel for the reboot that's coming out in June, I believe. But these two will always hold a special place in my heart. I absolutely love them. And I had to buy them as soon as I saw them. And as soon as I had money. But yeah, these movies are just purely amazing. You can't go wrong with it. Though, I will say I do miss the more of the serious tone that was in this movie. You know, this movie was more at a mix of serious and comedy. You know, basically how the turtles are in the comics. And then they had to take the serious out in this one. And in the third one, to appease two adults because this one was too dark for them. So yeah, love them. Might be in my top 10. Not entirely sure. Alright, so let's get these out of the way. Come here. Alright, so let's see if that's the last of them. That might be the last of them. Yeah, it might be. I really hope it's the last of them. I feel like I had more. Alright, so I think I'll save these four for last, for specific reasons. See if you can't see them. No, you can't. I have a little bit of that. Alright. First up, Daredevil, the extended cut. And let me just say, I love season one of Daredevil. Really loved it. But anyways, the extended cut. I don't remember what the theatrical cut was. That was about to fall. I don't remember exactly how the theatrical cut was. All I remember about the theatrical cut was there was a sex scene. Jennifer Garden. I'd fuck her. But yeah, there was a sex scene. That's all I remember about the theatrical cut. But I watched the extended cut and fucking loved it. It's a great movie as an extended cut. And a lot of people don't give the extended cut a chance because they didn't like the first one. Or not the first one, the original one. So if you guys saw the original one, didn't like it, haven't seen the extended cut, at least check this out. Give it a chance because, you know, given how I don't remember exactly how the original cut was, I really love the extended cut. I think it's a great film like this. It still has some issues, but it's a great movie. At least the extended cut wise is. Next up is a movie that I'm pretty sure you guys know how I feel about it. I just realized I did talk about Kick-Ass. It was in the Star Wars review. Huh. But yeah, this movie is pretty much goes in terms of, you know, Kick-Ass and Star Wars. If you guys seen my Star Wars review, you pretty much know where I'm going with this. The Avengers, the first one. I gotta own this on Blu-ray. But, yeah. What can I say that hasn't been said already about The Avengers? Nothing. Because this movie was pretty much amazing. I believe I like this one more than Avengers 2. But what Avengers 2 does better is the villain. Because Loki, good villain, but, you know, Ultron, he's a single entity that actually fights, you know, the heroes. So, and he also had a, oh my god, his plan was so fucking awesome. But yeah, I would say, though, I personally really enjoyed the Avengers 1 more. But that's not saying, it's like a very, like a very close contest with it. You know, here's Avengers 1 right here. And Avengers 2 is probably like right here for me. So yeah, really enjoyed the movie. Definitely my top 10. And then here comes the movies I cherish more than my balls. I don't know where that came from. The Amazing Spider-Man. Personally, I've already expressed my thoughts about the Amazing Spider-Man series. I personally find them more faithful than Sam Raimi's movies. You know, I feel like they got the Spider-Man character right, while Peter Parker, I feel like he was like the ultimate version, but a little bit more, I don't know exactly how to describe it, but I feel like they got the characters more accurate than the Raimi movies, because, god, the Raimi movies, I love them, but that's my biggest gripe, is that most of the characters are not right, at least in my opinion, especially Doc Ock. Oh boy. But yeah, Amazing Spider-Man. I really enjoyed this movie. A lot of people give it flack, though a lot of people enjoy it more than Amazing Spider-Man 2. Personally, I enjoy them both. Yeah, I really love this movie. And the CGI, you can tell, it's, a lot of people, I know people that don't like the CGI as much, but I like it, and it has a different feeling of CGI to me that a lot of other superhero movies don't do, in that it feels more vibrant in color. Like, it's more colorful. I don't know what it is, but the CGI, I just love the CGI, even though it's not amazing, like, say, Avengers-wise, but I like looking at it for some reason. I don't know why. But yeah, overall, I love the movie. I don't care what people say. I love the movie. I see its flaws, but I prefer it. Granted, I do love the Raimi movies, but if I had to say which one I'd rather watch, it would probably be the Amazing Spider-Man movies. Mainly for the accuracy, though I feel like I'm gonna get shit for it. But I will say, I don't know. I probably would watch this one over the Raimi movies because let me just talk about the Raimi movies now, since it's pretty much the last ones I got. Spider-Man 1, 2, and 3. Now, the reason why I would rather watch the Amazing Spider-Man movie or Amazing Spider-Man 2 movie over these is mainly because the plot is usually the same. And it's kind of my same thing with Toy Story. Now, granted, it does. I would say Spider-Man 3 is more different than the first two, which the first two are widely praised. But I feel like the plots, in a way, are similar to each other, especially the fact that, well, I don't know. I feel like I'm just talking out of my ass. I don't know. I love both of them pretty much. I love the Raimi movies and the Webb movies a lot. But I love them a lot. The Webb movies have something I like more, while the Raimi movies have something I like more as well. But I will say this. At least for Amazing Spider-Man movie, like Electro's plot in Amazing Spider-Man 2 was goofy. I did like it. I don't know, with the kind of plot you can do with Electro, it doesn't seem like he can have anything good to do, which is probably which, I'm starting to get tired. But you guys get what I mean. His plot with how he is, there's not really a lot you can do in terms of like what's his evil plan. Spider-Man 1, Green Goblin, his plan, in my opinion, was stupid. It fit, but it's stupid. I feel like with a plot like his, what I think they should have done, like if it was made nowadays, is tease the Green Goblin. Have him pop up in a couple movies, doing what he does in this movie, but have him have an overall plot that leads up into like a third movie. Because I did not like what the overall plot was. Basically, half the movie's an origin, which I think the origin, personally, I think the origin is done way better in this movie than it was in the Web movie. I do like how they did it in the Web movie because it feels like the ultimate one, but Sam Raimi, he did a perfect job on the origins for Spider-Man 1. But after the origin's done and over with, the rest of the plot is basically Green Goblin trying to get Spider-Man to team up with him. And that's not really interesting. It's an overall great movie. I really loved it. But in terms of Green Goblin's plot, it fits for his character, with how he is. I definitely think he would do something like that in the comics. But I feel like they sh I feel like I personally feel like something like that would have been better if they kind of built it up throughout the movies. And then in the third movie, he would be the main villain. And, he has this other plot. So, yeah. Spider-Man 1, great movie. But my main problem is just with Green Goblin's overall plan or plot in the movie. It's just him trying to get Spider-Man to team up with him. Though I will say this, Spider-Man would probably be in my top 10. And I just want you guys to know this. Even though I love the Web movies, I don't think I would put it in my top 10 favorite superhero movies. Personally, I pr once I make the list, I one of them might pop up in it, but I'm not entirely sure. But Raimi's movies, at least the first one or second one, they're definitely in the top 10. So, just so you guys know, so I don't get any hate comments, the Raimi movies are definitely in it. I don't know about the Web movies just yet, but yeah. Spider-Man 2. I don't like what they did with Doc Ock. And this is where honestly where Mary Jane becomes an annoying character. And I feel like Mary Jane is definitely not the character she's supposed to be, because she feels more like Gwen Stacy in this movie than how she would be in the comics. Personally, for me at least. I liked how she was in Spider-Man 1, but this is where I started to not care. I did not like her. I really didn't. But Doc Ock, I did like him as a character, but I did not like how he was in the movie in terms of how, he's not like how he's supposed to be in the comics. Which in the comics, he does have a tragic story, but he's more of a mad scientist than anything, like pretty much every other Spider-Man villain. And he's supposed to be like this evil genius, someone who you can see leading the Sinister Six. Where in this movie, you really can't see that. And it's kind of a stupid nitpick, but that's just exactly how I feel. It's a perfect example as to why I think, these movies are not really accurate how the characters are supposed to be in the comics, especially Spider-Man, where he doesn't crack any jokes. The most jokes he cracks are like four, and that's in the first movie. He cracks maybe one or two in this one, and he cracks one in the third movie. And how MJ acts like Gwen Stacy, and Gwen Stacy feels more like Mary Jane. That's funny. J. Jonah Jameson, he's the only one that feels like J. Jonah. He feels like the character in the comics. But overall, I really do enjoy this movie. This is, in my opinion, though, this is exactly where, Sam Raimi kind of starts repeating the plot a little bit, damsel in distress plot. And I kind of feel like it's another Find Yourself movie, like how Spider-Man 1 was. So, yeah, pretty much. But overall, I really love the movie. This one might be in my top 10. It's overall, some of the things also kind of seem stupid too. Like the whole how he loses his powers and all that. That one I always thought was stupid. But overall, really enjoyed the movie. I really love the movie. Just it suffers. It's really where MJ starts becoming more of a stupid character, and my own personal nitpick on how Doc Ock is more of a different character than how he is in pretty much the comic books. So yeah. God, I'm gonna get so much hate for how I feel, or me expressing my opinion about the Spider-Man movies. Now, Spider-Man 3. I see the hate, but I enjoy the movie. I really did. And my neck. But yeah, I really enjoy the movie. I don't have as many problems with this movie as other people do. I definitely don't like what they did with Sandman. Venom, I'm actually happy with. A lot of people didn't like Venom. I love the design. I think if it's more with a more realistic look, like he's bigger than Spider-Man, but he's like a cracked mirror version of him. And I actually really like the design that they did for him. And with how Eddie Brock was, I was okay with it, but I think with what they did in the novel, because there was a novel, and they actually, just so you guys know, because sometimes you can't trust novels, because when I read the novel, I was like, this is what they're doing in the movie? This is fucking awesome. The novel was really fucking good. I actually have it up there. But, they actually did record these scenes for the movie. They just never added them. If you actually look them up online, you can actually find the scenes pretty much the way the book describes them, where, he act like Eddie Brock goes to Gwen Stacy's house, and her father pretty much threatens him to get off the lawn. That's one of the scenes. And then there's this entirely new take on how they did Venom, which was pretty scary to think about. And I really wish I could see it. But I really think if Sam Raimi were to release his director's cut, I think that would be such a better movie. But overall, I really enjoyed the movie. And with how they did Eddie Brock, I definitely wish they added those scenes that I was just talking about. I will say this though. I could do without Sandman. That was my biggest issue. I did not like what they did with Sandman on how they made him be the killer of Spider-Man's uncle. I hated that. I fucking hated it. And to be honest, I could do without Sandman in this movie, and I definitely think they screwed him up. They made him too much of a softie, and Sandman's supposed to be more of a hardened criminal. He does have a bit of a good side, but this is another example of why they just kind of screwed up the characters. Because he's just, in my opinion, he's too much of a fucking softie in this movie. I really did not like it. Though, I will say, seeing the effects for him is pretty damn cool. But you know, Green Goblin, he had to be in the movie. There was no escaping that. He had to be in this movie. I think Venom would have been actually a good choice to put in this movie. I don't know, but either way, if they took out Salmon or if they took out Venom, I could have lived without it. But Green Goblin, he had to be in the movie, plain and simple. You know, if someone says, you know, they should have cut Green Goblin out, no. After that second ending, after the second movie's ending, the Green Goblin had to be in it. There was no doubt about it. But I hated the design for the Green Goblin in this movie. I would have loved it more. Like, when they showed what the design was for the Green Goblin, I was so disappointed because I was hoping for pretty much something that looked exactly like Norman Osborn's costume. That way, maybe Peter would probably be like thinking, you know, is Norman Osborn alive? You know, how did he survive that? You know, make him think about it. But nope, they had to do a stupid skateboard thing where he reveals his face after 2 seconds. It would have been so awesome if they did that. But yeah, Spider-Man 3, it's definitely the weakest one in the Sam Raimi trilogy. But I still enjoyed it. I don't hate it. People think it's like one of the worst shits ever to ever walk the earth. Same with Amazing Spider-Man 2. You know, they compared this movie and that movie to Batman and Robin. But come on. Come on, you just... No. Batman and Robin, no. That was a bad movie. You know, and people comparing this movie and Amazing Spider-Man 2 to Batman and Robin. No. Just no. Well, that's pretty much it. I will see you guys later. I am sorry for another long video. I didn't think it would take this long, but it did. I'm sorry about that. Now I'm going to end the video and take a shit because I'm feeling the urge right now. I'll see you guys next time. See you guys later.